prescribed under the mister. We had survived to turn on the history channel and ask our esteemed panel, why are we alive? And here's how they reply. Yo, what happens when two substances collide?
Mary Covert Jones was born on September 1st, 1896, in Johnstown, Pennsylvania. She enrolled at Vassar College in 1915, where she took every psychology course that was offered except one. Covert graduated from Vassar in 1919, and during that following summer, she attended a weekend lecture in New York City, given by behaviorist John B. Watson. During his lecture, he explained his well-known research with Little Albert. The following clip outlines his study.
At first, Albert shows little fear. Albert is also unafraid when he encounters a white rat for the first time in his life. But then, Watson shows Albert the rat accompanied by a loud clanging noise. One of the few things that upsets Little Albert. And he does it again. And does it again. Eventually, Albert learns to fear not just the rat, but all furry things, even without the loud noise. In Watson's mind, the Little Albert experiment is a success because it proves that fears are learned, not inherited.
It was after attending this lecture that Mary Covert Jones decided to pursue her graduate work in psychology. Covert began graduate work at Columbia University in 1919 and completed her master's degree by the summer of 1920. While serving as an associate in psychological research at the Institute of Educational Research at Columbia University's Teachers College, she began conducting her experiment of Peter with the help of Watson, who, by this time, had been excused from academia and working only as a consultant.
Was a toddler who had an intense fear of all white furry things. She treated Peter's fear of white rabbits by experimenting with a variety of fear-reducing procedures. Her most successful procedure was direct conditioning, in which food, a biologically related stimulus, was introduced. The food was presented simultaneously with the rabbit. As the rabbit was moved closer and closer and was presented with Peter's favorite food repeatedly, he was able to touch it, and the fear of the rabbit eventually extinguished.
Today, Peter is her most cited research, and it has influenced the work of many psychologists, including Joseph Volpe.
Joseph Volpe treated soldiers suffering from Moore neurosis while he was a military medical officer during World War II. Volpe concluded that the standard method of drug therapy was not very effective on these types of patients. And by 1958, he had developed a non-psychoanalytic, empirically validated behavior therapy called systematic desensitization. Systematic desensitization uses counterconditioning to reduce fear and anxiety symptoms. The goal of desensitization is to reduce the debilitating fears and anxieties in patients by using relaxation techniques while being gradually exposed to fear or anxiety-provoking events or objects. In the early 1970s, Volpe named Mary Covert Jones the mother of behavior therapy, crediting her work in counterconditioning as a major stepping stone for other forms of behavior therapy, including cognitive behavior therapy.
A lot of the behavior therapies started with the work of Mary Covert Jones, who really wasn't recognized, and Joseph Volpe in South Africa, who was determining how to treat anxiety problems using behavioral approaches. What he realized was, following up on the work of John Watson and his fabulously ethical experiments with Little Albert, that one did not need any sort of unconscious process to either create an anxiety and subsequently didn't need any sort of psychoanalysis to undo it. It could be undone using conditioning principles, and that's what he did. People think that cognitive therapy is devoid of any behavioral principles, but in essence, cognitive therapy and rational emotive therapy was always in part behavior therapy. It was always cognitive behavioral therapy. Understanding that behavior is maintained through specific cognitions and principles of reinforcement that come from certain behaviors that we all produce. Therefore, in order to get relief from any sort of psychological problem, if therapists can intervene at the level of the thinking and at the level of the behavior and realize that those things really cannot be separated apart, you can then get any type of behavior change you want. And indeed, cognitive behavioral therapy has been demonstrated after about 30 to 40 years of good science, really to be the go-to therapy for almost any sort of psychological problem. In essence, the cognitive behavioral therapy always starts with a cognitive behavioral conceptualization, where the therapist figures out what are the cognitions and what are the behaviors that maintain the behavior. The interest is in the maintenance of the behavior. It's not so much about the cause of the behavior. Once we identify the hypothesized maintaining cognitions and behaviors, then we intervene with both operant and classical conditioning principles, usually operant conditioning, to work on the behaviors. And we use cognitive therapy techniques in order to change the cognitions. When you use both of those together toward a specific treatment goal, then the person usually gets relief pretty quickly.
Cognitive behavior therapy has become an effective way to treat patients with PTSD and many other anxiety-related disorders.
Going back to Mary Cover Jones, in 1927, she moved to Berkeley, California with her husband, Harold Jones, when he accepted the position of Director of Research at the recently established Institute for Child Welfare at the University of California, Berkeley, and she took a position there as a research associate. She was appointed Assistant Professor of Education at Berkeley in 1952 at age 56. In 1959, 1 year before her retirement, she became full professor. In 1960, she served as president of the Division of Developmental Psychology of the APA. She received the G. Stanley Hall Award for APA in 1968. Although she began her research career as a behaviorist, her work later in her life reflected a more holistic theoretical outlook, which emphasized the whole person in their developmental, environmental, and social context. In a keynote address at the first Temple University Conference in Behavior Therapy and Behavior Modification in 1974, she made the following statement.
"Now I would be less satisfied to treat the fears of a three-year-old or of anyone else without a later follow-up and in isolation from an appreciation of him as a tantalizingly complex person with unique potentials for stability and change."
Mary Cover Jones died in Santa Barbara, California on July 22, 1987. She was almost 91 years old.
Let's take a better look beyond storybook and learn our souls are all we own before we turn to stone. Let's go to sleep with clear